Sredni Vashtar by Saki. Conradin was 10 years old, and the doctor had pronounced that the boy would not live another 5 years. The doctor was silky and effete, and counted for little, but his opinion was endorsed by Mrs. de Rope, who counted for nearly everything. Mrs. de Rope was Conradin's cousin and guardian, and in his eyes she represented those three-fifths of the world that are necessary and disagreeable and real, the other two-fifths, in perpetual antagonism to the foregoing, was summed up in himself and his imagination. Mrs. de Rope would never, in her honestest moments, have confessed to herself that she disliked Conradin, though she might have been dimly aware that thwarting him for his good was a duty which she did not find particularly irksome. Conradin hated her with a desperate sincerity, which he was perfectly able to mask. Such few pleasures as he could contrive for himself gained an added relish from the likelihood that they would be displeasing to his guardian. In the dull, cheerless garden, overlooked by so many windows that were ready to open, with a message not to do this or that, he found little attraction. In a forgotten corner, however, was a disused tool shed, and within its walls Conradin found a haven, something that took on the varying aspects of a playroom and a cathedral. He had peopled it with a legion of familiar phantoms from his own brain, but it also boasted two inmates of flesh and blood. In one corner lived a ragged, plumaged hooden hen, on which the boy lavished an affection that had scarcely another outlet. Further back in the gloom stood a large hutch fronted with close iron bars. This was the abode of a large polecat ferret, which a friendly butcher boy had once smuggled, cage and all, into its present quarters, in exchange for a long-secreted hoard of small silver. Conradin was dreadfully afraid of the lithe, sharp-fanged beast, but it was his most treasured possession. Its very presence in the tool-shed was a secret and fearful joy, to be kept scrupulously from the knowledge of the woman, as he privately dubbed his cousin. And one day, out of heaven knows what material, he spun the beast a wonderful name, and from that moment it grew into a god and a religion. Every Thursday, in the dim and musty silence of the tool-shed, he worshipped with mystic and elaborate ceremonial Sredni Vashtar, the great ferret. Red flowers in their season and scarlet berries in the winter time were offered at his shrine, for he was a god who laid some special stress on the fierce, impatient side of things. And on great festivals, powdered nutmeg was strewn in front of his hutch, an important feature of the offering being that the nutmeg had to be stolen. On one occasion, when Mrs. de Rope suffered from acute toothache for 3 days, Conradin kept up the festival and almost succeeded in persuading himself that Sredni Vashtar was personally responsible for the toothache. After a while, Conradin's absorption in the tool-shed began to attract the notice of his guardian. "It is not good for him to be pottering down there in all weathers," she promptly decided, and at breakfast one morning she announced that the hooden hen had been sold and taken away overnight. With her short-sighted eyes, she appeared at Conradin, waiting for an outbreak of rage and sorrow, which she was ready to rebuke with a flow of excellent precepts and reasoning. But Conradin said nothing. There was nothing to be said. Something, perhaps, in his white, set face gave her a momentary qualm, for at tea that afternoon there was toast on the table, a delicacy which she usually banned on the ground that it was bad for him, also because the making of it gave trouble, a deadly offence in the middle-class feminine eye. "I thought you liked toast," she exclaimed with an injured air, observing that he did not touch it. "Sometimes," said Conradin. In the shed that evening there was an innovation in the worship of the hutch god. Conradin had been wont to chant his praises. Tonight he asked a boon. "Do one thing for me, Sredni Vashtar." The thing was not specified. As Sredni Vashtar was a god, he must be supposed to know. And choking back a sob, as he looked at that other empty corner, Conradin went back to the world he so hated. And every night, in the welcome darkness of his bedroom, and every evening in the dusk of the tool shed, Conradin's bitter litany went up. Do one thing for me, Sredni Vashtar. Mrs. de Rope noticed that the visits to the shed did not cease, and one day she made a further journey of inspection. "What are you keeping in that locked hutch?" she asked. "I believe it's guinea pigs. I'll have them all cleared away." Conradin shut his lips tight, but the woman ransacked his bedroom till she found the carefully hidden key, and forthwith marched down to the shed to complete her discovery. It was a cold afternoon, and Conradin had been bidden to keep to the house. From the furthest window of the dining room, the door of the shed could just be seen beyond the corner of the shrubbery. He saw the woman enter, and then he imagined her opening the door of the sacred hutch and peering down with her short-sighted eyes into the thick straw bed where his god lay hidden. Perhaps she would prod at the straw in her clumsy impatience. And Conradin fervently breathed his prayer for the last time. But he knew, as he prayed, that he did not believe. He knew that the woman would come out presently with that pursed smile he loathed so well on her face, and that in an hour or two the gardener would carry away his wonderful god, a god no longer, but a simple brown ferret in a hutch. And he knew that the woman would triumph always as she triumphed now, and that he would grow ever more sickly under her pestering and domineering and superior wisdom, till one day nothing would matter much more with him, and the doctor would be proved right. And in the sting and misery of his defeat, he began to chant loudly and defiantly the hymn of his threatened idol. Sredni Vashtar went forth. His thoughts were red thoughts, and his teeth were white. His enemies called for peace, but he brought them death. Sredni Vashtar, the beautiful. And then, of a sudden, he stopped his chanting and drew closer to the window pane. The door of the shed still stood ajar, and the minutes were slipping by. They were long minutes, but they slipped by, nevertheless. Conradin stood and waited and watched. Hope had crept by inches into his heart, and now a look of triumph began to blaze in his eyes that had only known the wistful patience of defeat. Under his breath, with a furtive exultation, he began once again the paean of victory and devastation. And presently his eyes were rewarded. Out through that doorway came a long, low, yellow and brown beast, with eyes ablink at the waning daylight, and dark, wet stains around the fur of jaws and throat. Conradin dropped on his knees. The great polecat ferret made its way down to the small brook at the foot of the garden, drank for a moment, then crossed a little plank bridge, and was lost to sight in the bushes. Such was the passing of Sredni Vashtar. "Tea is ready," said the sour-faced maid. "Where is the mistress?" "She went down to the shed some time ago," said Conradin. And while the maid went to summon her mistress to tea, Conradin fished a toasting fork out of the sideboard drawer and proceeded to toast himself a piece of bread. And during the toasting of it and the buttering of it with much butter and the slow enjoyment of eating it, Conradin listened to the noises and silences which fell in quick spasms beyond the dining-room door. The loud, foolish screaming of the maid, the answering chorus of wondering ejaculations from the kitchen region, the scuttering footsteps and hurried embassies for outside help, and then, after a lull, the scared sobbings and the shuffling tread of those who bore a heavy burden into the house. "Whoever will break it to the poor child? I couldn't for the life of me," exclaimed a shrill voice. And while they debated the matter among themselves, Conradin made himself another piece of toast.